In this part of Sussex, we are surrounded by history. From Pevensey in the west, where Duke William landed, to the town of Battle north of Hastings, and West Ord's Rye with its medieval parish church with links to Normandy. Not forgetting Hastings with its castle and historic old town. Many visitors who come to Hastings flock to see the old town with its historic homes and ancient churches. Down on the beach, or Stade as it's called, is one of the last beach-launched fishing fleets dating back to the 14th century. We can see and experience all this whenever we wish to do so. Unfortunately, there is one thing we cannot see. It is larger than an individual painting. It has more colour and vibrancy than the Bayeux tapestry and is a tribute to the skill and expertise of those who made it. It is the Hastings Embroidery. It is hoped that this film will give the embroidery a new audience and remind others of the celebrations held in 1966. The then County Borough of Hastings had decided to celebrate the 900th anniversary of the battle, and the celebrations organiser, Group Captain Ralph Ward, suggested an embroidery along the lines of the famous Bayeux tapestry. The Royal School of Needlework, under its principal Mrs. Grace Hamilton King, was commissioned to create the 27 panels with a total length of 243 feet, or 74 metres. These panels, brilliantly coloured and masterpieces of the needlewoman's art, display some 81 major events in this country's history during those 900 years. The Hastings embroidery uses threads, cords, metals and appropriate cloth, feathers even, from the Parrot House of London Zoo, but needlework predominates.
William, Duke of Normandy, claimed that he was the rightful king of England. He believed that the crown had been promised to him by Edward the Confessor and that Harold Godwinson had conceded that he should be king. Harold heard the news of the invasion on the day that he had overwhelmingly defeated the forces of Harold Hardrada at the Battle of Stamford Bridge in Yorkshire.
Harold immediately marched his army over 200 miles south to Senlac Hill, 6 miles north of Hastings. This is Senlac Hill. The date is the 14th of October, 1066.
The scene is set. The ships are very like those shown in the Bayeux tapestry. Below the depiction of the Hastings coat of arms, William leads the attack on Harold. The banner with the yellow cross shows that William has the blessing of the Pope. Every year, hundreds of enthusiasts from all over the country gather in the field below the abbey to reenact the battle. The Saxons get the cheers and the Normans the booze, but it's too late to wish for a different outcome. A hail of arrows flies towards the wall of shields, one of the arrows, true to legend, threatening Harold. The king falls, and with him the standard of England. Looming in the background is the dark bulk of Battle Abbey, built on the spot where Harold fell. With the death of one man, so was the course of England's history changed. We now move to Westminster Abbey on Christmas Day 1066 and the coronation of William the Conqueror. It was attended by both Normans and Anglo-Saxons. It has been suggested that the enthusiasm of those inside the abbey was mistaken for rioting. The church was cleared, and just a few priests concluded the ceremony. The Battle of Hastings did not end the resistance to William. Everywhere lands were confiscated and given to the Norman barons and the knights who had been part of the conquest. Castles were built all over the country, probably the most famous being the Tower of London. In 1086, the Domesday Book was completed. Virtually nothing escaped the eyes of the compilers. William Rufus was the third son of William I. He was successful in conflicts in Normandy and Scotland, but he was cruel and extravagant, so there was little sorrow when he was killed while hunting in the New Forest by an arrow shot, it is thought, by his companion Sir Walter Tyrrell. Henry I succeeded William Rufus in 1100. When his ship, the White Ship, was sailing from Normandy, she struck a rock and foundered. 300 people drowned, among them Henry's only legitimate son, Prince William. Here we see a lone survivor, half dead, struggling ashore. The map shows Henry's possessions at the height of his power, stretching from the borders of Scotland all the way to the south of France, very nearly half that country. Henry II was the first in a long line of kings, the Plantagenets. Here we see the institution of the jury system. Henry II gave this country a number of legal reforms. This led him to quarrel with Thomas Becket, which was to hold precedence, the law of England or the law of the church. The traditional story tells us that Henry, discussing his problems, asked, almost as an aside, "Who will rid me of this troublesome priest?" Four knights took the words as a serious request, rode to Canterbury, burst in during Vespers and murdered the Archbishop, cutting off the top of his head. Henry regretted his outburst and did penance at Canterbury. Becket was canonized in 1172, and his shrine became a place of pilgrimage. The scene of martyrdom is now marked by a single candle, moving in its simplicity. Alongside this scene is another of King Henry's reign. Strongbow was the surname of the second Earl of Pembroke. He went to Ireland in 1170 to assist Dermot, King of Leinster, and on Dermot's death, himself became king. On the left of panel 5 is Richard, best known as Richard the Lionheart. He was the third son of Henry and Eleanor of Aquitaine. He landed in the Holy Land for the Third Crusade, hoping to relieve Jerusalem from the Saracens. The Crusades kept Richard out of the country for most of his 10-year reign. His statue outside the Houses of Parliament perpetuates a heroic reputation which few men have earned and fewer have deserved. Because of Richard's long absences during the Crusades and as a hostage held for ransom, his brother John ruled in his place. It was a rule under which England suffered. Whether he lived in reality or only in the persona of Errol Flynn, Richard Todd, Kevin Costner or Russell Crowe, to name but a few, we cannot leave out Robin Hood. We like to think of our legendary hero living in Sherwood Forest with his band of merry men, which included Friar Tuck and Little John. Associated with the idea of robbing the rich and giving to the poor, Robin fell foul of the Sheriff of Nottingham. Here we see Robin has captured the Sheriff and leads him past Maid Marian and the outlaws. While Robin may be legend, our next scene is the very opposite. Richard died in 1199 and John became king. His reign was disastrous. By 1215 the barons had had enough and forced him to sign the document known as Magna Carta at the island of Runnymede in the River Thames. This document is important because it became the symbol of the supremacy of the constitution over the king and was interpreted in later years as a guarantee of liberties. From this moment on, no one could be above the law. It is now 1258, and the barons compel Henry II to hand over government to them. Their leader was Simon de Montfort. He defeated Henry after a short civil war at the Battle of Lewes in Sussex. The centre of the panel shows Edward I, Henry's eldest son, known both as the Longshanks and the Hammer of the Scots. Conqueror of Wales, he is here seen presenting his son at Carnarvon Castle. In 1295, he called the Model Parliament and made changes to the laws and the legal system. We now come to the defeat of Edward II by Robert the Bruce at Bannockburn. By this victory, Bruce restored Scotland to her independence. The centre of the panel depicts the 100 Years' War. The title comes from the struggles between England and France from 1337 to 1453, which included the Battle of Crecy and, on the right of the panel, Poitiers. It was at Crecy that the Black Prince, Edward, son of Edward III, led a division of the English army when only 16 years old. Here we can take a closer look at the intricate work that has gone into this section. It took 3 weeks to complete. The original Black Prince's helmet is over his tomb in Canterbury Cathedral. The wars spill over into the next panel, where on the left, the burghers of Calais, the town's chief citizens, plead for clemency from Edward, who has marched on the town after Crecy. After the Queen supported their plea, the burghers were granted clemency. No such appeal could prevent the tragedy of the Black Death. The disease appeared in Europe in 1348 and soon invaded England. It was a bubonic plague, so called because of the swellings in the armpits and the groin, the infection coming from the fleas carried by rats. Death came just a few hours after catching it. No exact figures exist, but the death toll was probably as high as 500,000, perhaps a third of the population. Towards the end of Edward's reign, perhaps one of the most outstanding religious figures was John Wycliffe. We see him here with the first translation of the Bible into English. He made many controversial statements and was lucky to escape condemnation as a heretic. The Black Death was a great inconvenience. It caused a serious shortage of labourers. The feudal system was breaking down. The Peasants' Revolt of 1382 was led by Wat Tyler and John Bull. At Smithfield, Wat Tyler met the 14-year-old King Richard II. Allegiance to the King was avowed, and Richard said, "I am your only captain." Then it all went wrong. After a disturbance, the Lord Mayor killed Wat Tyler, and blood was shed on both sides. Look at Richard's horse. The needlewomen used an Indian damask shawl for the cloth, and the bridle is pure gold braid. Despite his patronage of learning, Richard's reign was almost totally unsuccessful, ending with his abdication in 1399. In the centre of this panel, we meet the poet, writer and diplomat Geoffrey Chaucer, best known for the Canterbury Tales. Here, he watches the procession of pilgrims on their way to Canterbury. After the succession of Henry IV, Owen Glendower proclaimed independence for Wales. with himself as Prince of Wales. For the rest of his life, he was in active warfare with England. It proved to be the last chance of independence for Wales. Glendower, who claimed descent from the old Welsh princes, was defeated near Usk in 1405 by the soldiers of Henry IV. His son Henry was no more than a lad, and won renown in the campaign, commanding part of the army. This was the beginning of the Lancastrian dynasty. Henry was made Prince of Wales in 1399, becoming King Henry V in 1413. He also claimed the throne of France, and in October 1415 won the great victory at Azincourt, the third victory in the 100 Years' War. It was here that the fearsome longbow, an invention from the Welsh borders, was the decisive weapon. The casualty figures say it all. English, 300, French, 10,000, including the destruction of much of the nobility of France. In the centre section we turn from war to Dick, later Sir Richard Whittington, along with his cat and bow bells, which told him to turn again. Because of that call from the bells when on Highgate Hill leaving London, Dick returned to the city to become Lord Mayor not once, but three times. The bow bell story may be true, but unfortunately there is no evidence for the cat. Never mind, where would we be without him? And to support our love for the animal, here he is, worthy of a Lord Mayor, with sealskin coat and mink whiskers. And then to Henry VI. Much of his life was quite tragic, but he did succeed in founding King's College Cambridge and Eton College, their coats of arms being beautifully reproduced here. The Wars of the Roses, the civil war in England, began in 1455. According to legend, the leaders of the factions, Henry's supporters the Lancastrians, and the Yorkists, picked a rose each from the Temple Gardens. Red for the Lancastrians and white for the Yorkists. Once again, the craftswomen of the Royal School have risen to the occasion. The roses are literally masterpieces. I've noticed the collar and cuffs, mink no less, although this Canadian fur would not have been originally worn. We are now nearing the end of the Middle Ages. First, William Caxton, the country's first printer. He had learnt his art overseas and set up his press at Westminster in 1476. Richard III was the last of the Yorkists. He is seen here dispatching the princes in the Tower, the crime which causes controversy even today, many believing him innocent. We also see the arrival of the first Tudor, Henry VII, as victor over Richard at Bosworth. Richard III was immortalised by Shakespeare with the cry, a horse, my kingdom for a horse. Faithfully enacting the legend, we see Henry plucking the crown from a bush on which it had fallen at the end of the battle. A new era dawns. America has been discovered. Henry VII had sent the Italian John Cabot to find a new sea route to Cathay. He made two voyages from Bristol, discovering and exploring part of the coast of North America, called appropriately Newfound Land. Perhaps Henry could be seen as tragic, but we now come to a very different kind of king. Henry VIII is seen as he may have been in his prime. He became king in 1509, and here he is meeting the King of France on the field of the Cloth of Gold. Each vies with the other in their splendid regalia. Once again the ladies of the Royal School have excelled themselves, Look at the costumes. More damask, but for this, the Royal School generously donated this piece from their own private museum. The reign was turbulent, with divorce from Catherine of Aragon, the brief marriage to Anne Boleyn, the split with Rome, and the dissolution of the monasteries. There were four more wives, giving rise to the famous way of remembering what happened to them. Divorced, beheaded, died, divorced, beheaded, outlived. Henry had only one legitimate son, with Jane Seymour, but Edward IV was only king for 6 of his 16 years. If the religious changes of the previous decades were not enough, there now follows a period of even more strife. Seen here dressed in green, with her half-sister Elizabeth in blue, a little poetic license here, Mary, daughter of Catherine of Aragon, was an ardent Catholic, and succeeded to the throne on the death of Edward. She had a poor marriage to Philip of Spain, and restored the Roman Catholic religion, and at the same time began the persecution of the Protestant martyrs. This has caused history to refer to the Queen as Bloody Mary. She died in 1558 from what is thought to have been cancer, misdiagnosed as pregnancy. Now we come to the Elizabethan age. She was the daughter of Anne Boleyn, and for the first part of her 45-year reign, she was occupied with the establishment of the Church of England, very much as it is today. The next section commemorates Sir Francis Drake and the circumnavigation of the world in the Golden Hind. Here we see him being knighted at Deptford. A replica of the ship can be seen near Southwark Cathedral. Another famous seaman was Sir Walter Raleigh. The Queen gave him a commission to take possession of as yet unknown territories in her name. This he did, founding the colony of Virginia, named after the Virgin Queen. In the centre of this panel is Mary, Queen of Scots. She was Elizabeth's cousin, but was a Catholic. She had laid claim to the English throne, and after many years of imprisonment in Fotheringay Castle, she was brought to trial to face evidence obtained through trickery. It was with a heavy heart that Elizabeth signed the death warrant. Mary was executed in 1587. The right of this panel records one of the greatest fleets ever put to sea, the Armada. In 1588, its ships, 130 of them, carrying 20,000 troops, arrived off the southwest coast of England and then sailed up the Channel. We all know the story of Sir Francis Drake and his legendary game of bowls on Plymouth Hoe, but our scene, and how cleverly the Royal School has created it, is of the defeat of the Armada in Calais Roads. Many of the Spanish galleons were destroyed by fireships, and the rest were driven into the North Sea and were caught by storms off the north of Scotland. The threat of invasion was removed. The Elizabethan age is probably best summed up by the reported words of the Queen as she addressed her troops before battle. "I know I have the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a king, and a king of England too." The Elizabethans may well have been stout-hearted, as with Drake and Raleigh, not forgetting the Queen herself, but among them all, the name of William Shakespeare shines. Here he is in the shadow of the old Globe Theatre, now rebuilt. Elizabeth died in 1603 and was succeeded by the son of Mary, Queen of Scots, James. The thrones of England and Scotland were united. The family tree takes us all the way to our own Queen Elizabeth. Sir Thomas Rhodes' four-year visit to what was then known as Hindustan laid the foundations of British India and we see him here presenting his credentials. To the right of the panel is someone we remember on November the 5th each year, Guy Fawkes. His plot to blow up the king in Parliament was foiled, and in company with his fellow conspirators, he lost his head in 1606. Our historical journey, as depicted in this Hastings embroidery, takes us to another important journey, that of the Mayflower in 1620. Carrying 108 passengers, the Mayflower left Plymouth bound for the New World and a new life free from religious persecution. Some 10 weeks later, they arrived. A hard winter followed, with over half the company failing to survive. Now we come to the Civil War. Charles I had invoked the doctrine of the divine right of kings and insisted on absolute rule. He dissolved three parliaments, ruled without one for 11 years, and then introduced such extreme religious measures that by 1642, civil war became inevitable. The Cavaliers anticipated early victory, but they underestimated the strength and conviction of the Roundheads of the new model army. You see them here in red, led by Oliver Cromwell. 4 years later, with much bloodshed and families rent apart, Cromwell succeeded. As a result, Charles I was tried in Westminster Hall, convicted, and then executed in January 1649. On the right of the panel, a direct reversal, the Restoration. After just over 10 years of a republic, with Cromwell as Lord Protector, his son Oliver succeeded him, but he soon resigned, and the Rump Parliament was formed. Charles was invited to return as king, and he reigned until 1685. A tradition dating from this time can be seen at the state opening of Parliament. The Queen sends Black Rod to summon the members of the House of Commons. As he approaches, the door is slammed shut, demonstrating the supremacy of the Commonwealth which Charles I had violated. The Great Plague of 1665 was the first of two disasters in the reign of Charles II. The pestilence, like its predecessor the Black Death, was a bubonic outbreak which ravaged London. The total number of deaths in that year was 68,596, in spite of two-thirds of London's population of nearly 500,000 having fled the city. Notice the doors of the houses marked with a cross as victims are moved into the street. The second disaster was the Great Fire of the following year. We may call it a disaster, but it may have been a blessing in disguise. Although it devastated the city after breaking out in Pudding Lane, it served also to cleanse the capital after the infection of the previous year. The fire raged unabated for 5 days, destroying two-thirds of London, including 13,000 homes, and caused nearly 250,000 people to be made homeless, although casualties were few. One of the most interesting eyewitness accounts of the fire is that of Samuel Pepys in his famous diary, in which, after a few details of the fire, he recounts how, along with his gold, he buried his Parmesan cheese in the garden. Among the very fine buildings to perish was Old St. Paul's, which gave a unique opportunity to the 34-year-old Christopher Wren. We meet him on the right of the panel. He had been appointed Surveyor General and Principal Architect. His new creation of St. Paul's forms the background to our scene. More than 50 other churches were designed by him. He was knighted in 1672 and now lies in the crypt of his most famous creation under the masterly epitaph, Si monumentum requiris, circumspice. If you seek his monument, look around you. Our next scene is of what became known as the Bloody Assizes. Following the Monmouth Rebellion of 1685, culminating with the Battle of Sedgemoor in Somerset, the last battle fought on English soil and won by the army of James II, the rebels were convicted and sentenced by Judge Jeffreys. Look closely at the jailer's hand to the right of the scene. Yes, they're real keys belonging to three of the needlewomen who worked on this particular section. A clever touch of realism to a cruel episode. In the centre of the panel, William of Orange arrives at Brixham in Devon. The year is 1688. James had so alienated the people by becoming a Catholic that William was invited to take the crown. William's mother was the daughter of Charles I and Mary was the daughter of James II, but staunchly Protestant. James fled to France and then went to Ireland, where he was defeated by William at the Battle of the Boyne in 1690. The consequences of this battle affect us even today. The events of 1688 have become known as the Glorious Revolution. On the right of this panel, we see the Battle of Blenheim. In 1704, John Churchill, the Duke of Marlborough, following Louis XVII's attempt to defeat Austria, marched the English armies to Bavaria, where, with Austrian troops under Prince Eugene, they defeated the combined might of the French and Bavarians. The first major victory on continental soil since the Middle Ages. For this scene, the Royal School drew its inspiration from a tapestry hanging in Blenheim Palace in Oxfordshire, where another Churchill was born in the next century. Now to happier news and the much longed for union of Scotland and England. Although the crown of the two countries had been united, they continued with their separate parliaments and generally acted independently. In 1707, Queen Anne, sister of Mary, signed a treaty which incorporated the countries as the United Kingdom of Great Britain. At last, there could be a common currency, mutual trade, and other benefits. Queen Anne reigned for about 12 years, but in spite of many pregnancies, she left no heir. The succession went back to the daughter of James I, from whom was descended the Elector of Hanover, who became George I. Robert Walpole, featured in the centre of this panel, had entered Parliament to begin a notable career. It is in this section that we find the one piece of woven tapestry in the entire embroidery, the carpet. On the right is Bonnie Prince Charlie. He was the grandson of James II and also known as the Young Pretender. He tried to regain England for the Stuarts. He was proclaimed King of Scotland in 1745, took Edinburgh and invaded England as far as Derby, but had to retreat. He was defeated at Culloden and hid in the mountains of North and West Scotland for 5 months before fleeing to France. Some 12 years after these events, the focus turns to India and the victory of Robert Clive at the Battle of Plessy. The centre section tells another sad story of another soldier, James Wolfe. He is seen here planning the attack on the Heights of Abraham, which would win Quebec. Wounded in the attempt, he died at the moment of victory. The right of the panel shows one of the more colourful events of our story, the famous Boston Tea Party. It is in this section that the Royal School called upon the services of London Zoo for assistance. After all, what else could you use for the Indians' headdresses but feathers? The zoo obliged, collecting some fine specimens from their parrot house. Here they graced the disguised Boston citizens, who are letting the British government know in a most direct manner what they think of the duty on tea. The western and northern coasts of Australia had been known for years, but in 1770, Captain James Cook landed in Botany Bay and then sailed the length of the coast. He returned to Hawaii, where he was killed by natives. The chronometer in the bottom right-hand corner of the panel refers to his first visit to Hawaii to observe the transit of Venus. In the center section, we see the enactment of one of the most significant events in American history, the Declaration of Independence. 13 English colonies on the eastern seaboard made the declaration, thus forming the original United States. Thomas Jefferson may have been a man of vision, but even he could not have foreseen what would result from that momentous statement made on July the 4th, 1776. To the right of this scene, we move into modern times. This is the Industrial Revolution. Changes were being made, transforming the self-supporting agricultural village life and domestic industry to the factory system and modern industrialization. Invention and discoveries mark the period. Steam power flourished and coal was king. The cities of the north became a sea of chimneys and their skies turned black. The attitude towards the people who came to work in the new industries remained largely unenlightened, as witnessed by the children deep below ground, working as beasts of burden. So now to sea, with the Battle of Trafalgar, and the death of England's greatest sailor and hero, Horatio Nelson. Here he is, mortally wounded on the deck of his flagship HMS Victory. It took exceptional skill to reproduce the decorations and epaulets of Nelson and his officers. Around them, the battle rages, while above him, out of sight, flies the immortal signal, "England expects that this day every man will do his duty." He'd been doing his since first he went to sea as a boy of 12, and now at 47, he dies in the service of his country. To the right of Trafalgar is another battle, this time Waterloo in Belgium. Arthur Wellesley, the Duke of Wellington, commanding the combined British, Belgian and Dutch forces, defeats Napoleon as he attempts to reach Brussels in June 1815. After 10 hours, Wellington, aided by the Prussians, secured victory and at the same time decided the future of Europe. Napoleon abdicated and went into exile on St. Helena. As you look at the scene, notice Wellington's footwear. Would you believe it? Real leather for his boots. What an eye for detail those needlewomen had. On the right of the panel, yet another great Briton, George Stephenson, and his railway engine, the Rocket. This wasn't the first engine, but surely his most famous. In 1825, the first public railway was opened between Stockton and Darlington. The Rocket made its first appearance 4 years later to run on the line between Manchester and Liverpool. Now we're introduced to Florence Nightingale. George Stephenson knew poverty, but this famous woman came from a wealthy family. Much against her parents' wishes, she chose to train as a nurse. Taking 38 women with her, she went to the Crimean War to nurse the wounded. Thanks to her reforming zeal, the death rate in the hospitals dropped in 4 months from 42% to 2%. By the way, in yet another delightful touch by the Royal School of Needlework, the red bedspread you see is nothing less than a small piece of the Mayor of Hastings' robe. Dominating the centre of this panel unmistakable, is Queen Victoria, who came to the throne as a girl of 18. The British Empire flourished during her reign, and at one time she ruled over more than a quarter of the entire globe. Created Empress of India in 1876, she died in 1901, having celebrated 4 years earlier, 60 truly glorious years as sovereign. The Boer War, the subject of the next scene, still raged when Victoria died, not ending until the following year. However, the great moments of the war were the relief of Ladysmith and of Mafeking. Only a few years later came the Great War of 1914. Our scene depicts the tank, first used for offensive purposes by the British Army during that military tragedy, the Battle of the Somme. After 4 years of slaughter on both sides, and the loss to this country of nearly 1 million people, in November 1918, the armistice was signed, and it is that moment that we keep on Remembrance Sunday. It is appropriate that our next illustration is of war graves. Did the needlewomen of the Royal School weep as they carefully stitched the red poppies which relieved the sombre scene? Turning away from the horrors of war, we now come to the first direct flight of the Atlantic. Responding to a prize offer of £10,000, in 1919, two RAF officers, John Alcock and Arthur Whitton Brown, flying an open cockpit Vickers Vimy aeroplane, left St. John's, Newfoundland, to arrive 16 hours later at Clevedon in Ireland, thereby claiming the prize. This was a far cry from the air-conditioned comfort and speed of today. Our journey through history also begins to move rapidly, and we see the first television broadcast by John Logie Baird. Hastings had a part to play in this marvel of modern communications, since Baird, suffering from ill health, moved to the town in 1923. Experiments with his then crude equipment conducted above a shop in Queen's Avenue, directly across from the town hall, allowed him to transmit the shadow of a cross over a distance of just a few feet, the first transmission in the world. Alongside John Logie Baird in the centre of the panel is captured the spirit of the Battle of Britain, fought in the skies over southeast England during 1940. As invasion by Germany threatened, defiantly, tired young men for fighter command climbed their Spitfires and Hurricanes into the sky to do battle and rout the enemy. 3.5 years later came the invasion of Europe by the Allies. Nearly 400 years after the Armada sailed the Channel waters, in 1944, another great armada was seen, this time carrying thousands of troops from Britain, the Commonwealth, and the United States, storming the beaches of Normandy, from where Duke William had sailed 9 centuries before. The Army of the West fought a series of furious battles until, on May the 8th, 1945, the Germans surrendered. Achievement of quite a different kind is captured in our next scene, with the excitement and elation at the news of a great conquest in Nepal. Mount Everest had been beaten, and news reached the crowds thronging the capital for the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II. Sir Edmund Hillary and his Sherpa, Tenzing, had set foot on the peak of the world's highest mountain. The British team had been led by Sir John Hunt, and the achievement came on May the 29th, 1953, 4 days before the coronation. It seemed that a new Elizabethan era was dawning. In the centre of the panel is seen the Commonwealth of 1966. Many countries which had been colonies but had gained independence remained in the Commonwealth. On the right are some facts and figures relating to 1966, they make an interesting comparison with the present day. On then, to the last of the panels, and the end of our journey through almost a millennium. Firstly, one of the great men of modern times, Sir Winston Churchill. Seen from behind, he gives his wartime salute, the V sign. There is the ever-present cigar, and in the background, ships returning to port and a special flypast. As with many famous people, Sir Winston had a link with Hastings, since he was a member of the Winkle Club, which has its headquarters in the old town. The Winkle shown here reminds us of the gold Winkle presented to Sir Winston, which can be seen in his old home, Chartwell. As mentioned earlier, he was born at Blenheim Palace in 1874, and he died in 1965. Next to Sir Winston is a reminder of Hastings' uniqueness, with the arms of the ancient Cinque Ports. The chief officer of the Cinque Ports is the Lord Warden. Today, it is an honorary post, the appointment by the sovereign being a reward for long service to the country or commonwealth. Among recent holders have been Sir Winston Churchill and Robert Menzies, while at the time the embroidery was made, the Lord Warden was Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother. Her Majesty held the post until her death in 2002 at the age of 101. The final scene in this video presentation of the Hastings embroidery is a depiction of the regalia of Her Majesty the Queen for her coronation. The impression of realism is stunning, the jewels flashing in the light and the gold of the orb and ampulla gleaming. Much has changed in the 46 years since the Hastings embroidery was made. Perhaps one day we may be able to see the real magnificent record of our amazing heritage on public display in its own dedicated exhibition hall, just as the ancient Bayeux tapestry is honoured in the town of Bayeux. Could it be that in 2016, when we celebrate the 950th anniversary of the Battle of Hastings, we could see another panel to bring our history up to date? Deciding what to depict would be an interesting task.